shout out to everybody who hit me and was upfront about the monster under the steps snatching your Achilles tendon. I got a bunch of texts from people, grown men who was in their 40s, who was like, yo, I'm not going to lie to you. I'm glad you said it. They was like, yo, when I leave the basement, because you know, like, you last one up, you got to turn everything off. They was like, yo, when I leave the basement and, you know, you click the light off and then you hit all of them stairs in the pitch dark, they was like, yo, I do high step them last, like, 4 or 5 steps. Bro.
To this day.
To this day.
This day.
To this day.
This week, our show is brought to you by our partner in crime, Organifi. Organifi is an organic superfood supplement line that makes quality, trusted nutrition convenient and accessible. Their most popular product, Green Juice, can supercharge your life, restore that glow, and help you feel decades younger in just 30 seconds per day without having to worry about shopping for ingredients, mixing and blending them, and then cleaning up afterwards. All ingredients are USDA organic, vegan friendly, and made without GMO ingredients, gluten, or soy.
Organifi just launched a green juice with a slight twist, guys. They've added their crisp apple, right? Apples have arrived, introducing the refreshing taste of new Organifi green juice crisp apple. All the benefits you've come to love in the classic reset green juice with a new juicy twist. Enjoy the same fan favorite nourishing ingredients, ashwagandha, moringa, spirulina, chlorella, designed to hydrate, energize, and support cortisol balance. The new green juice, the crisp apple juice, guys, is made with organic, wholesome, hand-picked apples, and it tastes like a fresh, juicy slice in every sip. If mint just isn't for you, this refreshing new recipe certainly is. Making it the first of its kind, the whole family will love. All right, so the kids can get in on this one, guys. Apple juice, as you've never tasted it before, now for a limited time. Take the meh out of the mornings with the green juice apple crisp from Organifi.
Make sure you guys check it out at www.organifi.com/success. That's organifi.com/success.
I wake up every single day. I am who I say I am. And I get what I get because I live in beast mode. Stop being gazelles. You're not average. You're not even good. You were born to be great.
What's going on, world? Welcome to another edition of the Secret to Success podcast. I'm your host, CJ, joined as always by the Bayesian sensation, Mr. Carl Wesley Phillips.
What's going on, y'all? What it do?
Hello, Carl. You...
What's up?
Okay, I know I'm not the only one who peeped. I ain't seen Carl without that hat.
Oh, dude. Oh,
come on.
Okay, hold up.
What hat?
Hold on, man. Hold on.
Well, I saw it, but I wasn't paying attention.
Carl got a new hat.
Come on.
Carl, you had the Boston hat
At least 20 years.
Wait. Wow, that's how you know he getting to the money, dog. Dang, look what it took.
It's the little stuff.
Carl was like, okay, deeper than the brand going crazy, I'm going to have the red bit. Come on, it looks sweet.
No, that's deep because my wife said something the other day about, like, you could tell Didi pay attention and stuff because she like, This changed. So you just was like, the hat changed.
Oh, no
so
doubt.
You picked that and was like, okay, oh, money, yeah. The bag is behind it.
Oh, for sure. I already know. Carl, explain. Come on.
I'm just following the pattern.
It's
the pattern.
Been years.
The pattern. It's I see the years. Pattern. Hey, for those that don't know, the B was Barbados for me. That one, Boston. That was just to keep me connected. Everybody like, hey, well, Boston, I don't care nothing about Boston. I don't know nothing about Boston. I don't even watch baseball for real.
Yeah, that's a white thing, too. Yeah. This is a PSA. I don't know if I said it before, but let me say it to all the white people in the world. 90% of the time when you see a black dude with a hat on, it ain't necessarily his favorite team.
You know what I'm saying?
Right. So it might just match the fit or something that. But sometimes I might have had like a White Sox hat or like, you know, a Dodgers hat or something. Yeah. And they like, oh, you like the Dodgers.
I like the blue.
Couldn't tell you one player.
It go with the Air Force Ones.
That's all it was. So yeah,
I hate to disappoint. But
I was just rocking for the home team, and then now I'm rocking for the new home team. That's all.
Yeah, woo. Dr. King in the building. Dr. King, how you feeling?
Man, I'm great, dog. Yeah. Back, man, from Florida. Oof, hot.
Oh, definitely. We'll get into that. Hip Hop Preacher,
what's up, fam?
Yeah, how you feeling?
Grumpy. You know what I'm saying?
Grumpy old man.
No, I was telling Ma, man, for real.
Yeah.
Like, I get it now. you talking some like 20-year-old talk, 30-year-old talk. And it's not that you talking 30-year-old talk, but I'm trying to tell you and you still talking the same talk. And I'm like, man, bro, I don't got a lot of time left on this earth and I don't want to spend it like this. So now I see it's like, oh, it's not grumpy. Ma, I used to say it was grumpy when we was little. Get off my grass. I thought
Get
it was grumpy.
Get off my grass.
I'm seeing what it is.
Boy, I kick. Yeah, yo. What?
Yeah. I see now, Ma, it's focus.
Yeah.
It's like, yo, I'm concentrating. I have a limited amount of time. I want to make sure whatever. So, yeah, I'm just at that place.
He grumpy. Yeah. Speaking of grumpy, you know, like, crazy, bro, on the plane. Like, y'all just, it be people just going through life just pissed.
Yeah.
Like, but like, in rude. Like, bro, you ever just be, like, in line with somebody or, like, behind somebody who, like, just everything is pissing them off?
Yeah.
I'm like, bro, like, dude at the airport this morning, I'm like, okay, first of all, if you got here late, that's your fault. You know what I'm saying? But, like, it was an older lady in front of us, and she was in the TSA clear line, you know what I'm saying, like, that whole thing. And she in front, and she don't quite got her boarding pass, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
My man, I ain't say nothing to my man because, you know, I ain't want him to say nothing where I had to slap him up. You know what I'm saying? You know, but I'm like, dog, like, it's an old lady, bro.
Right.
Like, he just behind, like, and then he, like, finally, like, zoom around her. And then he gonna go jump in the line and, like, throwing all this stuff. I'm like, bruh, like.
Was he over 50?
He was.
Yeah. Yeah.
How'd you know?
Grumpy old
man.
You know
what I'm saying? He don't got time.
He ain't got time for that.
But I'm just messing up his
like, he had a way that he wanted to get things done. And he got there and you switched up. Cause you ain't had your ticket ready.
I'm just saying.
He should have been
107.
Oh yeah, he should have had a little patience then.
I'm talking about 175.
Yeah.
I'm like, bro, grandma, what you want grandma to do, bro? She this hurt. You know what I'm saying? She old. Like respect. It's just people just be doing too much, man.
They do.
And the people who try to like act like they don't know how to file off the plane.
Mm. Oh, bro. I'm talking about move you out the way.
I told you. That's the one time I seen my wife ready to scrap. I'm talking about one time. Bro, she like literally was ready to scrap. Lady was like Debo pushed like past her. Like she was in the aisle. Candace went off. I was like, okay, we'll back it down a little bit. But people who don't like, they don't know how to file in. It's like, bro, come. What are you doing?
It's like we got to, you know, this they go first and they come out. I'm like.
Should we talk about the first class problems, or is that not say it? Can I text E the other day?
Trouble for that.
I could take control for that. Don't say that one. You know what I'm talking about?
I do.
The left and right. Yeah, oh, bro, I ain't gonna say that one. First class problems.
Yeah.
Look, Maul looking like what's going on?
What happened?
Let me just say this: anybody who ever had to go on a plane where you fly first class and you walk to the left, right, the big plane where like the first class is to the left and then to the right. After that, let's just say the deboarding process is not fair.
and I see it happen all the time.
Yeah.
I do. It really just depends on who the stewardess
the flight attendant that's standing there.
Yeah, it depends on if they are high.
Yeah.
Like a super high eye.
No, they ain't
trying to tell nobody.
No.
Put the rope up.
I or F.
Wait.
Like, yeah,
I'm like, wait a minute. Like, I paid $600 extra for this ticket. Hold up. And you know what else making you mad these days? Delta, y'all getting sloppy with the Sky Priority tags.
Oh, bro. It don't even make sense.
Bro, they tag. So,
that I want to have a discussion.
Okay, come on. I knew I could get even.
No, I'm just saying, Ma.
Yeah.
You put priority on there.
So that when you land at the airport.
Because I'm getting off first. Bags come off first.
Come off first.
It's time. I'm 51. It's time. I want to save all my time.
Yeah.
Bro, I promise you, we got off. I think we was in San Diego. Mm-hmm. Bruh, I thought my bags didn't make it.
Mm.
They came so late.
Yeah.
And them jokers came like 30 minutes later.
Yeah.
With the Sky Priority on there.
Yeah.
The yellow priority on there. I'm like, what made you grab those last?
I'm last.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
Yeah.
Didn't they have some that said your bags in 20 minutes or less? I thought they had some disclaimer by 20.
In Atlanta, they do.
Oh, no. Atlanta's the best.
Atlanta.
Atlanta, as soon as you get
off. That's because all the CEOs be flying out of there.
No, I'm just being honest with you. Depending on what region you're in, San Diego, California, they don't open stuff up at 5, 6 o'clock in the morning.
Right,
it's a different swag. So they like, don't come here rushing. This is surfing.
Yeah,
we laid back. This is different kind of money.
We
laid back. So I always know, relax, chill. But this time, bro, usually my stuff will come maybe in the middle. This time it was like one bag came in 20 minutes, one came in 30.
Oh,
I just sat there. I just sat there.
I'm just saying, when you fly a lot, it make a difference.
It does.
It could be like an extra 4 hours in your week by the time you count all that foolishness up. You know what I'm saying? So shout out to them, though. Shout out to everybody who hit me and was upfront about the monster under the steps snatching your Achilles tendon. I got a bunch of texts from people, grown men, who was in their 40s, who was like, yo, I'm not going to lie to you. I'm glad you said it.
Yeah.
They was like, yo, when I leave the basement, because you know, like, you last one up, you got to turn everything off. They was like, yo, when I leave the basement and, you know, you click the light off and then you hit all of them stairs in the pitch dark, they was like, yo, I do high step them last, like, 4 or 5 steps. Bro.
To this day.
To this day.
To this day.
To this day, I'm high stepping them last steps. So I appreciate everybody being honest. But, man, we had a discussion in the car on the way over. I don't know if Grumpy Old Man, if he want to discuss it. But, E, you were with our the youth. The future today. I don't know if you want to bring it up. Maybe it's something we could talk about. Maybe not. I know that's why E in a bad mood, if y'all want to know.
Hey, what was that first one called in St. Louis?
Nothing funny.
Nothing funny, too. Next Friday.
Still ain't funny.
Friday afternoon.
Still ain't funny.
Still ain't funny. No, bro. I was in Detroit, east side of Detroit. We're on the east side and the west side. Shout out to Detroit Public School System, Sound Mind, Sound Body. And so we're on the east side, and man, when I tell you they cutting up, bro. Like, these kids, bro, they cutting up, bro. I'm talking about talking to each other, like, loud about it, whatever. I start speaking. They ain't, you know, they still talking while I'm speaking. And, you know, I just went there, bro. Like, and I'm older, so it wasn't, like, as much aggression as it was, you know, back in the day. And I still think it's important to hold people accountable. But I kind of try to reason with them a little bit more, because I know when I did it in St. Louis, you had maybe like one or two people that, you know, got offended by it. But my thing is this, bro. Like, how is it that you don't get offended when kids are disrespectful, unruly? Like, how you mad because I care enough to challenge them? You feel me? Because it's like I told the kids. I said, look, first of all, y'all know who I am. Y'all understand the sacrifices I made academically. You know how much money I make. You know how busy my schedule is. Let's just be real. You tell me somebody else on my level who went in school with y'all.
Nobody.
Right. I'm like, bruh. I said, bruh, I'm not trying to be funny. And I called some names out. I won't call them out in here. They wasn't recording there. But I called some names out. And I'm like, yo, it's people who are on my level. Bro, they walk around with security. I'm in this joke. I'm on the east side of Detroit on the train, on the solo. I ain't got no police, no security. I'm in here by myself. Like, I didn't put my dog on. I'm putting myself at risk up off of this joint to be with y'all. And I'm not mad that y'all acting crazy, but I want
to
know
why. I want to make sure people understand, though, because they look at you and, you know, a lot of people who listen to this podcast, of course, are fans of yours and supporters and all of that. But when you go into these schools, even though the kids may recognize you, whatever, it's not what y'all think. Like, it's not like they come in like, oh, E.T., and everybody sit there with a notepad. And, like, this is and obviously, these kids been dealt a bad hand. We, like, please understand that we know that, right? Like, this is, we fully aware of that. But what E is saying when he goes in there to challenge them on, okay, yes, but now what? I think that's what you're talking about.
And, I bump a bad hand. Like, if you was in elementary school, bad hand. Middle school, bad hand. You in high school. You playing football or baseball or whatever. You playing video games, you could be quiet. You going to a movie, you could be quiet. So I'm like, yo, I don't want to hear that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You have the ability to be quiet and pay attention when you want to. You feel me? So you dating, you know how to be. you feel me? Like, you know rules when you trying to. So for me, it's like, yo, y'all just got to tell me what's up, because I'm here. I care. Like, talk to me. Like, tell me anybody else that you know on TV or whatever. Tell me somebody else that's making the kind of money I'm making. Tell me when they come in here talking to you. Like, just give me a name of somebody else who's, I just drove 1 hour and 45 minutes. I didn't fly. I drove 1 hour and 45 minutes. And it's the summertime in Michigan. So you know what that means. It's construction. So it ain't like
everywhere.
I'm just driving straight through. It's construction everywhere. And I'm still here. I just want to know why you not taking school shit? So I tell y'all what really hurt me. So I was like, how many of y'all just don't like school? If you had a choice, you wouldn't be here. 99% of them raised their hand. I said, all right, cool, I get it. Now, how many of you, when you take these tests, you don't take them serious? 10% raise their hand, we don't take tests serious. How many of y'all take it serious? 10% raise their hand, we take it serious. I'm like, yo, that's 75, 80% of y'all that didn't even, bruh. Like, I ask you a question and to raise your hand, and you can't raise your hand? I'm like, yo, this is unacceptable. And this is the problem I have. The problem I have is they've given up on you. And they've given up on you because you're doing this. And you've given up on you. And I'm here, and I haven't given up on you. So it's not fair that I'm in here, and you don't care, but I care. So let's just talk. Let's just talk. Because, like, I don't got to come back. I'm just being real. Like, I don't have to come back. If this is a hassle for y'all, and y'all don't want the information, I'm good. Bruh, I done created a PowerPoint. Y'all tell me when the last time y'all saw me with a fire video and I done had a PowerPoint presentation. I don't even do that. I don't even like doing PowerPoint. I got a PowerPoint. We got finer computers. We, bruh, they got the old pop-up screen. I guess that's called projector screen. Yeah. Like the one when y'all was in school, like in elementary. You take that out the folding boy.
Oh, no doubt.
Put that joke up. They had the the projector so old, you take one thing and slide it and it clear the boy up. You push, you flip, like you got to push the lever and then it go back or forward. This is what kind of material we got in the school. So I'm saying, y'all, I go, when I go to these events, bro, they got everything set up before, the mic, everything. I ain't got nothing in here. Do you know how many professional speakers would just go, bump that? Y'all ain't got no mic. Y'all ain't got no, like, I'm through. I'm like, okay, let me do, I'm in there. I'm on the email, downloading, getting the whatever. I'm putting the stuff up the screen, pulling it back.
How was you doing it? I just want to
you
get the people
me?
The visual.
You know what I'm saying?
ET. You know ET don't email like get on no
you
computer.
Know what I'm on. I'm trying to do it. I'm trying to remember what my code is.
You got
ET
on the typewriter.
Right. I'm on the go. You know what I'm saying? And so I just was like, let's just stop. And I will say this. When I went in, they stopped. But here's why I was upset. I had a whole team for him. Katie, literacy, she about to show him whatever. I had Train, who worked the Boys and Girls Club. He about to take him through. TJ, Lil D. And now it's at a point where I can't even use my team. I got to do it by myself now.
Why is that?
Because, you know, Katie ain't used to dealing with that type of, you know what I'm saying? Katie from Grassland School System. Yeah. She used to, y'all come in, y'all sit down, y'all.
Catch this information and get up out of here.
You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's what she used to. Even Train.
So you literally saying, like, the climate in the school is so rough that you can't even bring in your team because nobody else can hold them. Ain't that crazy? Like, think about that. Like, I got people who I'm trying to bring, like, think of how bad our school, and by the way, that's why I tell y'all in the car. I said, think about this. You want to be really scary with it? These kids are showing up for summer school. These the kids who came.
Right.
I'm talking about high school students that actually, they cared enough, at least somebody cared. You got a mama, a grandma, somebody made you come up here.
Yeah. What about that other group?
It's a whole nother group who ain't even thought about coming up here.
Right.
And so you talking about really kids who actually showed some fortitude to get up here.
Yeah.
And that's what we up against in our school systems and in our neighborhood. So go ahead.
And again, I'm up for the challenge. I ain't tripping. I ain't running. I ain't scared. Let's go. But we're not going to sit here and play this game. Tell me why you don't care. Because I care. And I asked them, am I wrong for caring? Because maybe I'm wrong for caring. Maybe I shouldn't be here.
So you literally just had a dialogue with them. Like, hold on, cut the speech.
No more presentation.
That's the lead.
I'm like, yo, I just want to know, because a lot of people gave up on y'all and quit. I'm here. Are you telling me that they right? So just tell me the truth. Are they right? Maybe I shouldn't be here. Maybe there's a reason why they don't come. I'm looking at them like, oh, why y'all doing y'all thing? Y'all ain't coming back to the school system. Y'all ain't helping out. And they like, oh, we don't care. And I was like, oh, okay. Why don't you care? Well, I'm only 16. I was like, oh, what does that mean? I'm too young to care right now. I got a lot going on. I was like, oh, okay, at what point should you care? Oh, when I get 25. I was like, last time I did my math, in the inner city, 25, if you ain't got no plan, you either dead or in jail.
Yeah.
I haven't seen a 25-year-old just coast and make it. Well, so, you know, so we start going back and forth. What you need to do? Play video games. I said, listen to me very closely. I'm not about to play no video games. Grumpy. I'm not about to play no video games with y'all. You're 16, about to be 17. I'm not playing no video games. And I explained to him the little Jewish kids I saw in L.A. who was doing the field trip at the Chase Bank.
Chase Bank.
Mar, I promise you, when I saw those kids, I was like, man, one little kid had to use the bathroom real bad because they in a single file line at Chase.
Mm.
He had to use the bathroom real bad. Come out later, and I saw a homegirl who was with them, and I was like, yo, what y'all still doing here? What's going on? She's like, oh, we just took them in the bank. I said, to do what? Get a bank account. I said, get a bank account.
What age?
Like, yeah, they was at 10, 11. And she was like, well, they getting ready for bar mitzvah.
Which is 12.
And they got to make that deposit.
And they got to make that
deposit. They got to make that deposit.
They got to make the deposit. Sure. So, and then they figure out their life journey. Mm. Like, we're going to sit around. And I'm like, wow. Wow, you 16 saying. Meanwhile, in Afghanistan, a 12-year-old got a GAT. He like fighting for his country and his family, and he 12. He can't say, well, I can't defend my family until I'm 25. Bro, you're not going to have no family. And so for me, it was just like, y'all, let's talk. So I will give them credit. One thing they did say was, well, you know, maybe, you know, the talking is cool, but maybe if you spend time with us.
Hmm.
And so I was like, all right, here go my number. And to their defense, about 15 of them hit me up. Like, E.T., what up? Remember you was talking about the 150, the 50, the 15, and the 5? I was like, yeah, man, I need you to be in my 150.
Mm. What was that?
So I just break down, like, every
in
human,
a circle,
our circle is max, we got 150 people
in our
circle. And then 50 are closer to us. 15 is, like, super-duper important. Your 5 is your life or death, wife, mom, you know what I'm saying? So I was just showing them that. And they was like, oh, yeah, we need you in our 150 or our 50. And I was like, all right, fair. I can't talk every day, all day, but text me. We'll go back and forth when I can. About to do. Actually, I met a group of, man, there is light at the end of the tunnel. And I don't know if the company want me to say their name, so I won't say it. But there's an accounting firm that I work for in Chicago, Mall. And they brought in 161 of our brightest students. Yale, Harvard, Princeton, Howard, Clark, Atlanta, you know, whatever. And if they finish the program in 2 years, they get an automatic six-figure job working for this firm.
Oh, wow. Mm.
So these were some of the brightest kids I've ever seen in my life. They got some real questions. So I hooked up with a couple. I'm like, yo, let's start our own little business. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to get with them. They're like freshmen in college. And I'm going to have them start like GroupMe or whatever, the Web3, the Discord, and start a channel on there and help me work with these students as I go to these different schools, put them together in a group. We do videos for them. You know, have where we on Zoom, talk me on the Discord, talking to them, getting them on stage so they can ask questions. But I felt little man. He was like, a lot of them was like, well, can we call you? Can we talk to you? That would help us. And I was like, all right, cool. But most of them, it was, we not taking school serious because, one, we don't see where it's going, and two, we got a lot of stuff going on. And I was like, well, I don't know if it's going to change if you don't figure this thing out. Like, you got a lot going on at 16. Imagine with no education or no trade or no money at 25, how dangerous life is going to be. Yeah. You know, but wasn't discouraged. I wasn't even looking at these kids like, I can't believe they talking when I'm talking. I was more like, yo, y'all keeping the legacy alive. And I told them, I said, when you say I'm from Detroit, what does that mean when you say that? Mm. They was like, you know, bro, we've been there, done that. We don't take no. You know what? We shooting, kill, we whatever. And I said, can y'all do me a favor? Can we break the legacy and create a new one? Can we go, I'm from Detroit. We read 21 books a year. I'm from Detroit. We write books. I'm from Detroit. Yeah. My vocabulary is butter.
Yeah.
I was like, yo, can we switch the narrative? And can we start talk, whatever? So, but I did give him my number. And I'm like, E, be committed. Get all these freshmen that you work with. Yanni was, of course, at the magic program.
Yeah.
I'm like, wow, freshman, you know what I'm saying? Here, I'm like, yo, I'm about to recruit you. I'm about to put a lot of time in. She should be able to help me on these streets, make some stuff happen, you know? So, but yeah, I'm going to use technology to help these kids. I'm going to get involved. And I know y'all seen the video I put out by now, but I put a video out on Instagram. Watch it when you get a chance. And I was just saying to y'all, like, run the play, you know? I know y'all jet setting. I know y'all going on cruises and y'all, you know, y'all in countries taking pictures of where y'all are. Y'all got Bentleys and Rolls Royces, but run the play. Don't forget what Martin and Malcolm started. Run the play. You know, next time you go on a trip, take a little shorty with you. Next time, you know, you go to a restaurant, take a little shorty with you. Next time you go to a game and you on the floor of seats, take a little shorty with you when you go. You know, or do me a favor. I told y'all, I challenge y'all. Take an hour this summer to work with a group of kids. You know what I'm saying? So, again, I know our ancestors would be proud that we jet-setting, but they wouldn't be proud that we don't have lunch programs, or we don't have learn how to read programs, or we don't have whatever exposure programs, you know? So I would just say to those of you who balling, let's not give up on our kids, but let's challenge our kids. Let's not let them off, you know, off the hook.
Man, no, we appreciate that work you're doing, man. I wanted to let the people hear that because we had the conversation in the car. Yeah. He's still, you know what I'm saying, still grinding, doing his thing. But,
I've been grinding. I've been grinding for so long.
Yo, what's up, fam? It's your boy, E.T. Now, look, most of us, we know learning a second language in high school or college, it wasn't exactly the high point in our academic career. I did Spanish in college, but let me tell you something. It was difficult, to say the least. Right? But now, thanks to Babbel, the new language learning app that sold more than 10 million subscriptions, there's an addictively fun and easy way to learn a new language. Whether you're traveling abroad like your boy E.T., or connecting in a deep way with family or friends, or you just got some extra time on your hand, Babbel teaches bite-sized language lessons that you'll actually use in the real world. All right, so look, I learned a second language. Why? Because, and especially Spanish, because it's the second most spoken language in North America, right? And your boy E.T., quiero mucho dinero. So listen to me. Babbel's 15-minute lesson plans make it a perfect way to learn a new language on the go. So if Didi's in the mall, right? If I'm on a treadmill, right? If I'm, you know, at the airport, whatever. Like, I don't always have an hour or 30 minutes. So 15 minutes is the idea. Now, Babbel lessons were created by over 100 language experts. Their teaching methods have been scientifically proven to be effective. With Babbel, you learn up to 14 different languages. Like, you can learn up to 14 different languages. So you can choose Spanish, French, Italian, German, just to name a few. Plus, Babbel's speech recognition technology helps you to improve your pronunciation and accent. There are so many ways to learn with Babbel. In addition to lessons, you can access the podcast, the games, the videos, the stories, even classes, live classes. Plus, it comes with a 20-day money-back guarantee. So start your new language learning journey today with Babbel. So do me a favor right now. Stop what you're doing and save up to 60% off your subscription when you go to babbel.com/success today, right now. That's babbel.com/success for up to 60% off your subscription. Babbel language for life. It's your boy E.T. Now you know. Let's go.
So, Maul, man, let's get into it, bro. Back from Florida. Maul was texting me, sending me videos.
Yeah.
You done seen the other side, huh? talk to us, man.
I thought he had seen every side you could possibly see.
Man, he all the way on the left side.
Nah, just still exposure, man. I get excited for exposure now. I mean, I think you could put $1 million in front of me, and then you could put a certain level of exposure.
A5 and a certain level of exposure. Mm. I just want to know the limits. Yeah. The limits. Can
I? I got to admit, I got to say this on the air. CJ, I did cheat on you. Mm. I did have A5.
You wonder why we not friends no more.
In Florida.
I did have A5 in Florida, my man. Yeah. But, bro, I'm telling you, man. Just greatness, bro.
Yeah.
Just greatness, man. So we went out there. You know, we were blessed, man. Shout out to Jameer, Jermaine. Okay. You know, their wives, Natalie and Jordan. Mm-hmm. Man, a tennis family, bro.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, whole tennis family. You know, before we went out there, we was just big on, you know, Jermaine and his brother Jameer. They call hands. These are two players, man. They've been playing tennis. I'm talking about on a national level. All Americans, professional tennis players, coaching Venus, Serena, Naomi Osaka. Coco. Yeah. I mean, just unbelievable, man. These two, and they're brothers, man. These two brothers are just sharp. And man, we had to
not just black. They actually brothers, like they actually brothers.
Yeah. And man, it's just amazing. And so we knew, you know, we knew their story a little bit and how they came up in tennis. And they reached out to me and was like, man, we, you know, we love. They listen to the podcast, Make Real Estate Real. And they was like, we'd love to add value. Invited my daughters to come and train my daughters for the week, bro, in tennis. But man, I didn't have a clue. We sat down, we went to their house. You know, ate dinner, man. Natalie cooked a great dinner. And we found out their wives also played tennis. Wow. Not only they played tennis, but Jermaine's wife, Natalie, she was the first black tennis player at the University of Georgia. And now you would hear that and you would think, was this in the 60s? Right. Bro, this was in like 2006. In like 2006,
crazy.
The first.
Crazy.
She was like three-time All-American. You know, Jordan played at, man, I just told you. Temple. She played tennis at Temple. Really? So all of their wives, man, and they all knew each other since the age of like 7 years old. They all belonged to the same tennis facility back in Georgia. Mm. You know, and they all came up. And I was just blown away by their story, man. And just the love, man, that they had. And they, and you know, they sat there, man, every single day, bruh, early in the morning before the sun come out. And that's and before the sun, it was still about 90 degrees outside. And we out there 7 in the morning.
With the humidity.
Bruh, 7 in the morning. And they was like putting my daughters through with the same workout, Venus and Serena, Naomi Osaka, Coco Golf Get. Mm. And bro, they just show so much love. And my daughters, man, I mean, even, and you know what I'm saying, hopefully with one of their coaches ain't watching, but my daughters was like, dad, especially Jazz, I say Jasmine was like, dad. Oh, Jasmine was like, Jazzy was like, she pulled me to the side and she was like, dad, we need to fire our coach. Mm. Back in Chicago. She was like, we need, this is, she was like, this
the
is
the coach is listening. Your services is no longer needed.
So, bro, it was just, man, just a level, bro. It was something seeing like a master at work, bro. Just seeing some other professional. And these brothers, they were sitting up. We at the dinner table. And they like, man, Jemal, man, your story, man. Man, Make Real Estate Real, man. What you done? We flipping the property right now, man. Your story. And I'm just sitting back looking at them like, bro. Like your story.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
what you guys accomplished, man. Right. And not only what you accomplished, but what you can accomplish. Like literally, you know, they was kind of like, man, we didn't make it to the, you know, one brother's ranked like 100. Jameer was ranked 190th in the world. He played in Wimbledon.
Wow.
You know, but he still didn't make it, I guess, what you would consider like right. the top, you know, top. Type. But I'm
just
like,
bro. Made enough to be a multimillionaire.
Yeah, I'm like, bro, God got so much more for you, bro. Like y'all, all of y'all, like this ain't by chance. I'm like, I don't. Like, this don't happen. People don't just reach out. I'm from the podcast, and then all of a sudden, I'm just at your house. We sitting here eating dinner. I got my wife. Matter of fact.
So if you out there thinking about it.
Bro.
Hit E. E is
all about that life. So, yeah, man.
You got a better chance to get the
A5. Bro. Me and Camille, man, we were so blown away, man, by this family, bro, that for our 20th wedding anniversary, we went ahead and invited them out to dinner with us, bro, and set up an A5. I even gave my man A5, dog.
How did he like it?
How did he like it? How did he like it? Thing and make it good, bro. I'm talking about, man. It was just love, bro. My man was like, hey, whenever your daughters need any kind of coaching, anything, I got them.
Send them.
They definitely ready. Yeah. So it was just love, dog. It was just a great experience and exposure level. Even Jazzy was just walking different. People was just looking at my daughters like, yeah, these dudes, they don't just coach anybody. Somebody came up to Jasmine and was like, yeah, I know you from somewhere. You got to be somebody to be with you.
Yeah, because you with them.
Yeah, so.
I talked about that today, too, with the kids. I was like, yo, you stand with the right person, you succeed. You stand with the wrong person, you fail. I was like, yo, it's not what you think. Like, it's not how you feel about people. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's not how you feel. It's, you stand with a winner, you win.
Yeah.
You stand with a loser, you lose. And again, I don't mean a great human. They're great humans. But in terms of, like you talked about tennis, it's a difference between my man and my man. Like, and you ain't trying to be disrespectful. Mm-hmm. It's just an obvious difference. And when you stand next to a certain group of people, bro, the conversation is different.
All I keep hearing is Matthew Stafford. I'm sorry.
Oh, for real.
That's all I keep hearing.
Bro, then you go over here.
Yeah.
And again, it's the same, like Carl said, it's the same human. Oh. It's the same human. But you walk into a stadium where the sign says, we made it to the playoffs. You feel me? You feel me? I'm just saying.
1994.
I'm just saying, Mars.
We was in the off.
Mars, somebody. Holla at us. Somebody.
For those of y'all who don't know, what he talking about? The Lions put up a banner for making it to the playoffs. I think we put it on here before. I just want to reiterate. I know we got some new listeners.
Yeah.
But we got a playoff banner. Not a playoff win.
Yeah, no, but here's what I'm saying, though.
Just a banner. Like, yo. We made it. We made it.
But Maul, what I've come to realize, though, is that's a mindset. Somebody thought that it would be okay to celebrate that we didn't win, but we won.
Relatively speaking, that was our Super Bowl.
We didn't win, but we won. Ooh. Meanwhile, you go to L.A., and they're literally talking Super Bowl talk. Like, they're actually saying they're recruiting people to actually win a Super Bowl.
Yeah.
So they take a dude that I think got him to the Super Bowl. Mm-hmm. I think Jeff got him to the Super Bowl. They didn't
Jared,
win. But what's his name?
Jared Goff.
Goff is what I was trying to
say.
Yeah,
he played for the Lions now.
Oh, yeah. That was the trade.
I don't know, my man.
Hold on, man. Listen, man, we working on some things. We got new GM.
Yeah. So,
we did get the GM from the Rams, though.
Oh, beautiful. Mm. So, some kind of way that when they all come to Detroit, it do something. That
depends
water,
on who you stand next to. You just
but
said
I'm just saying, Mark, you just barely make it. You barely make it to the playoffs. You celebrate it.
Yep.
You go somewhere else where they trade. Mm-hmm. So, Goff left L.A.
Goff.
Yeah, Goff. He left
Goff.
L.A.
Goff. No.
Goff.
Yeah, Goff. Goff. Whatever it is. If he start winning some games, I know his name.
You remember his name?
I know. I hear it.
He called him Goff. Like.
He left L.A., came to Detroit, took them to the Super Bowl, didn't win, but came here and can't win.
Can't even win.
You switch one man, take him to the Super Bowl. And you know what's crazy? Stafford.
You don't think we're going to get to the Super Bowl?
Listen to me. Watch this part. This was crazy. Stafford literally did in L.A. what he's always done in Detroit, and that's have the ball for the last drive. Mm-hmm. That's all he ever done for us is be at the last minute. He got the ball trying to help us win, and then now he's in the Super Bowl doing the exact same thing and end up winning the game, doing what he always. And so I'm just saying, while I'm learning, it's not as deep as you think it is.
Do you think it makes you step up even more, though, when you come around you just yourself, or you come around, you feel the pressure to put up and be better.
The environment pushes you.
It's the environment.
Or,
yeah, I was about to say,
no, or
it's a culture.
Or me and Ma had this discussion 2 weeks ago. Either it pushes you.
What discussion?
It does exposure really. And Ma was like, "Yeah, don't forget this part. It can take you this way or this way."
Right.
So
two way street.
So what happens is the pressure either pushes you, or the pressure paralyzes you. Mm-hmm. But the cool thing about the pressure is that it's no purgatory. Like, it's no, you ain't stagnant.
Right. Yeah.
Under greatness.
Yeah.
That's the one thing that happens.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You ain't stagnant.
You don't know
no
one
more.
Way or the other.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you either gonna go this way,
always,
or you gonna go this way.
Yeah.
But you're not gonna ever feel comfortable 8-8. You feel me? You're never gonna feel comfortable 8-8. Mm-hmm. You either we building or we actually won. Mm-hmm. And so, I would say, for real, we have to be careful. And that's why I was telling the kids. I said, here go the challenge. You're in a school and you got to fight or get out. Because you just came into this auditorium and all we recognized was the kids that was acting a fool. Mm-hmm. So if the kids that's acting a fool is in here and they set the precedent acting a fool, even though you here to be serious, you can't even concentrate because they ain't here laughing. So my whole message just had to change. And now we focus on people acting a fool instead of you coming in here. And I was like, yo, if you're really a good student and you can't find in this environment, you got to get bust. You got to talk to your mom and figure out how you could Uber to another school district.
Wait, that's what the administration say. I know they were probably like, no, don't take our best students.
they wasn't in there. I was in there by myself.
He redlining his own.
Oh, bro. He like, y'all need to get out of here.
I'm not saying
but that's
get
real
out.
Talk, though.
I'm not saying get out, but I was just trying to explain to them.
Yeah.
And I was showing them pictures of, you know, people who I got with. I was telling the one dude, I was like, bro, he came up to me afterwards because this kid was asking me, like, how do you feel about your greatness? And I was like, bro, I'm going to be real with you. Like, I don't feel it like that. Mm. Like, I don't think it's anything wrong with believing in yourself and having confidence. But I was like, yo, I don't sit there and watch my stuff and do all of that. I said, I only know who I am because people come up to me and tell me whatever. So one of the coaches came to the back and he was like, yo, bro, I got to be real with you, bro. Like, I was going through this, trying to get through school, whatever. I listen to you every day. You got me through. And I said, man, I said, it's funny, bro. Some kind of way we start talking about who you hanging with. Because, he was saying the other coach that was there got him a job, helped him to go to school. He was driving back and forth from Detroit to Midland. My man hired him, made the school, helped him to finish his degree because he had never finished. He had got married early, had a set of twins early, and was like, just went to work. He was like, bro, I'm going to help you. And so he was like, yo, he helped me. He ain't going to tell you that, but he helped me. And I was like, you know what's funny? I was like, yo, I was at Michigan State University. I was doing my thing. And CJ came, and I was like, yo, you should have seen the look in his face when he said, bro, I'm going to make you a household name. I was like, bro, you should have seen the look in his face.
What did it look like? What was I looking
like? Like, I'm serious. Like, not.
Carl was sitting right there.
Like, not talking about it. And I don't know if C ever said anything else about it. Like, he never had the, like, you know how cats be like, I'm going to make you a household name, and they come back 6 weeks later, and Didi, I'm making that. Didi Mama, I'm making it.
Everybody. I'm making everybody. You get a household name.
I'm just saying, he never said it to them.
Yeah.
But he told me, and I was like, bro, you should have seen, like, the look in his eyes. And so I was like, I understand what you're talking about. And I was like, but the crazy part about it was I had other people that was with me that said that they gon'. And I said, yo, it makes a difference who you standing next to. Because for whatever reason, he took it to heart and did it. And I was like, now.
He was broke.
Right. And I said, now, Ma, it's a responsibility.
Yeah.
Because we were talking about other celebrities that don't speak to people. And I was like, now it's a responsibility because when you see me, I'm not acting like I don't know you. Mm-hmm. I'm saying whatever you want, however long you want to talk, whatever. I'm by myself, Didi.
I was telling somebody, I was talking to somebody yesterday, and they were just like, yo, how's E, like, with people and when they see people? I said, look, E, let me tell you something you've been doing, and I'm like, yo, I respect it. I'm like, E on such another level, and I can't remember if I said it before, but, like, you know, when people see him out and stuff like that, like, E's already super accommodating. He going to give you the full ET experience, but now he know that you want a picture, and he know you scared to ask for a picture. So he'll say, hey, you got your phone with you? Let's take a pic. Uh-huh. And it's like you see the weight come off of their whole life. Like,
because you know dudes be like.
Yeah.
We was in Vegas. And, like, of course, me and E in Vegas. And so, look, I told Candace, like, look, we just have to meet them at the hotel. Because he can't go two steps. But, like, E would take, like, you got your phone with you? Yeah, no. Like, and he'll hand it to me or whatever and be like, yo, take this pic. And, like, you could see the people, like, man, I wanted to ask, but I ain't, you know, I didn't. Yeah. And so you just see the relief come off them. But I did want to give you your props because I'm like, man, that's cool that you would do that for them and not just wait to see. Are they going? You know they want to pick.
Oh, you know it.
So he'll be like, yeah, you want to get a pick? Because it would be awkward if they was like, no, I'm straight. Just want to say what's up.
Yeah, no, even if you don't.
But, like, that, but they all, of course, they all want to pick.
Yeah, but I'm saying even if you don't, Carl, with the pictures that we be showing, the memories, I'm like, I keep telling them, like, I know you're going to want to tell somebody. You saw me. And
you remember what you used
to
do back in the day? He felt so awkward. They was asking for a pay. He was like, yeah, let's get one with my phone, too.
You used to be like,
what are you doing?
You know, like,
no, we both just get one. It's like it's both of ours.
It ain't like you doing it and you're a groupie. It's like we both groupied out.
I swear. You did stop doing that.
You
used to do that.
You're such a hot eye, dog.
He'd be like, yeah, let's get one with my phone, too.
He don't want them to feel like it. So he like,
Yeah, let me get one.
We both get one. Yeah. You get a picture. I get a picture, and I'm
going to
show my mama I was with you.
With you.
Yeah, I'm
with you.
Mama.
They ain't going to believe I'm with you.
And I would say that, like, I'm going to show my mom. Y'all, like, my mom ain't going to believe I was with a police officer.
I forgot about that.
I don't do it no more.
And then I used to really have to be sitting there like a whole goof, bro. Like, hold on, let me get one with Evo now. I used to not even be taking them. I used to be like, all right, you good. Just fake like I hit the button. Sorry, you were saying something.
I don't know what I was. No, I was just saying, who you stand next to is important, and this is what I told the kids. Yeah. Like, I know y'all got a lot that y'all are going through. I said, but here's the deal. It only takes one. Mm-hmm. Like, yo, is somebody in this school that's serious about school and serious about life that you could be best friends with for the rest of your life, and you don't have to go, it's 50 clowns in here.
Yeah.
You can literally go, there's one person that's serious about their life, and you can connect with that person and take off. So I was like, yo, be of hope. Mm-hmm. You feel me? Like, be of hope. One relationship can change everything for you economically. Mm. Expose, whatever. At one single relationship.
One decision.
Yeah.
One decision.
But that one decision with that, because I saw one kid, I asked a question. He was like, Like, he was about to raise his hand, then he looked around, and nobody else wasn't raising their hand.
Never mind.
So he was like, and I was like, don't do that.
Yeah.
I was like, bro, don't do that, bro. You was about to make a decision, and you change your decision for their decision. I was like, don't do that. You go with what you wanted to say. So, yeah, bro.
Yeah, it's crazy. You know, it's just crazy how we don't put the emphasis on education like that. And it's like, yo, it's hard to get the best and brightest to go back and teach for $35,000. You know what I mean? It's like, yo, cats graduating from college and
with $150,000 in student loans.
Bro, you want them to go back to the neighborhood and that's who we need. But it's like, man, it's.
I think it ain't even always even on the, just the teachers, bro. Like, they should have something that when you graduate from school, if you become successful, when you become successful, you have to come back
like
to show other people what
you
it
did recently. Because, I don't know, did you talk about that story? I don't remember.
Which one?
When you was just up at the school, and unfortunately, my man, the next day.
Yeah. When I was with Champs. Yeah, Vondale and them. And when I was in that class, bro, it was crazy. I went, boom, Vondale asked me to come speak to him. I always come speak to those, you know, young guys in Chicago.
Yeah.
And when I was in there, man, I'm just pouring my heart out, talking to these young guys just about, because they from Chicago. I'm from Chicago, too.
Yeah.
Y'all in the public school system?
I'm from
the public school system. I'm the result of it.
Yeah.
Vondale had them already. They already knew about me. A lot of them already, man. They had me up like Black History Month. I saw stuff that they made a long time ago in January. And I was just letting them know, like, bro, like it was nothing special about me. Like, I'm from the same hood. I'm getting the same education y'all got. Yeah. And then I'm just like, man, look, the thing is, though, I'm here because I need y'all to see what it looks. I need you to aim for something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I went around the room like, dog, what do you want? Like, what you want in life? You know, what's your goal? What you want? And a lot of, man, I don't know, man. I just, man. One guy was like, man, I just want to see 21. I was like, man, I went in on my man like, dog, that's not a goal. I'm speaking from my view. I'm like, that's not a goal. C21, I'm like, that should be a right. Like, that should be your human right. My man was like, man, everybody around me dying, bro, before the age of 21. So my goal is just to see 21. The guy next to him was like, yeah, dog. Like, man, my boys just get killed. I was like, man, look, y'all. Look, I'm here to tell y'all, like, hey, you got to look past that, all right? We got to look past. We got to set. So I had everybody in the room creating their visions, creating what they, how they see themselves in the next 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. I had them start with the end, right, in mind. Like, man, I want y'all, everybody in here, how many children you want? How many, your wife? I'm like, bro, if you don't see this stuff, it's not going to happen. So you got to see it before it comes to light. So I had them write out their whole life, bro. 10, 20-year plan. The guy that was next to the guy that was telling me about that, he wanted to live to see 21, got shot and killed 2 days later, bro. 2 days later.
Which is why it's this guy, Joe. Don't kill me, Joe. I'm sorry, John. I don't remember what his last name was. I did a podcast.
Golf.
Yeah, golf. It might be. You know what I'm saying? Easily. You know what I'm saying? So John was like, he said, E, I don't never hear nobody talk about this, but he was like, yo, the one thing that when I read your book and I watch your videos, that really struck me, you always speak with a sense of urgency. Mm. He's like, I ain't never heard none of your videos where you kind of just be like on chill mode. Mm-hmm. But he's like, as I read the book and I see the work that you do and who you do it with, I understand why now. And I was like, bro, it really don't have nothing to do with that. All of us gonna live real quick. Mm. And you know, the thing that pissed me off the most about myself is when I got my stuff together, I was like, I could have been doing this from when I was 20, bro.
Mm.
Like, that's the thing that hurt me the most. Like, yo, E, you could have been on the left side. Whatever your look, stupid. So one little girl read my book, and I asked her, what you think about it? She's like, I'm halfway finished. I was like, what you think about it, though? She's like, yo, I ain't trying to be funny. I ain't trying to dog you out. But you were stupid for leaving home at 16.
Oh, wow.
She was like, what was you thinking about? She's like, you ain't even had no plan. And I was like, yeah, you right. Don't you make that mistake. And she's like, yeah. And the other thing, she was like, yeah, you love Dee Dee. She your why. That's why you get up and do what you do. Mm. I need a why. Mm. Maybe it should be my mom. But you see a twinkle in her eye. Yeah. Like, oh, I see why you, okay. Like, she halfway finished, and she know the secret to success. Mm. And she was like, yeah, I got to figure out what my why is. And I just was like, yo, bro, that's why I speak the way I speak, because if I already know when I went to that school, Some of them kids was listening. And the ones that, this kid just texted me like, yo, you free now? Can you talk? Mm. I'm like, if nothing but the kids who text me and I call them, I already know they're going to be good.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it was like when I went in, it was like, this is harder than talking to the NFL, the NBA. Mm-hmm. This is worse. To me, this is, because they already, at least to some extent, have a community. They got bread. People want to know.
He went off on them juggers in the NBA the other day.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, bro, he went off on them juggers. We was in Catch in Vegas, and everybody having a good time. I'm talking about, it wasn't even this kind of party. I'm like, E, dog, let people breathe. I'm talking about all the NBA's, you know, stars floating through there. We in there chilling. Candace was in there with me. You know, we having a good time.
Sense of urgency.
E gets the mic. I'm talking about the end of the joint.
Yeah.
E gets the mic at the end of the joint. Ain't nobody hurt nobody. E in there talking about, oh, y'all think y'all sweet because y'all in here? 100 years ago, you would have been in here serving them drinks.
Not even 100.
Everybody was like,
not even 100.
Everybody 50 was years like, ago. Where did that come from? Like, he was like, no, you in here. Like, and he said it, of course, to say, like, yo, like, a lot of y'all get big time and then start acting like you here on your accord. Somebody 100 years ago was sweeter than you, was a better athlete, was a better whatever, a better speaker, a better author, whatever. A better
whatever.
What don't matter. Oh. And didn't have, through no other reason but their skin color, didn't even have an opportunity to be here. So let's start with the fact that you here on somebody else's stripes. And so he was like, I need a baseline for y'all before y'all start feeling yourself like that. And it was crazy because you saw the energy in the room like completely shift, and not in a bad way, in a good way, to where they were like, yo.
Reflective.
Because it was funny, like, he was there earlier, and it was like, of course, you know, all the bros gonna come up like, E, what up? You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, you know, cool. But they like hobnob in the room. And as soon as E finished, bro, it was like a line of them cats like, I need to talk to you. Like, kind of vibe.
The thing I said, Ma, was, yo, you're in a room that people would love to be in, but because you're acting like you're somewhere that you're not even about to get this opportunity. So you went here and bought an outfit to show them you somewhere, and you're not there.
Yeah.
But you're here, and you could go anywhere from here.
Oh, they felt so bad. They was in there, not felt bad, but they just, you could tell they was looking like, shoot, I was in here, but like, feeling myself to E start going crazy on me.
Yeah, you feel me? I was just like, yo, y'all, I'm in here. Like, y'all, I'm somebody. But I got on Chuck Taylors and some crazy shorts and a shirt. You feel me? Like, I'm not in here to try to act like I'm better than you. Like, I'm in here because we all can grow from each other and learn. So let's do that while we're in here and not be so big time that you leave and what you was in here for, which was supposed to be the network.
Yeah.
You're not even in here doing that. Some of y'all ain't even here doing that. Some of y'all trying to show me who you are. And there was a couple people that was like a little older that was like, I'm so-and-so and so-and-so. And I was like, he didn't know who I was. He was like, bro, I'm so-and-so from so-and-so and so-and-so. Here go my car. Who are you? I was like, I'm Eric Thomas. He was like, oh, and who was that? I was like, I ain't nobody. I just was telling him, I was like, oh, I ain't nobody. And so afterwards, he was like,
it was scary too. I was like, okay, I'm like, he really, I was waiting for him to be like, oh, my man was like, mm-mm.
I didn't say E.T. Hip Hop, I get no clues. I was just like, I'm Eric Thomas.
Oh, no, I said something.
Yeah, but then afterwards, you saw people like,
oh, bro,
you got a doctorate degree. Oh, you this? Oh, yeah. I ain't even. I'm like, bro, we not on that.
Yeah.
That's why I ain't come in with that. I came in with, yo, there's some powerful people in this room. And let me just say this. I want to respect my friendships with some of the people I have. But we're at a point, Ma, where we don't exchange money. We exchange influence. Mm. So it's like, E, if you got a book, you come on, Ma.
Which is worth priceless.
Woo. No, they like, bro, priceless, E, you got to, whatever you sell, whatever you got, you come. I got this many people following. I'm about to have them.
Yeah.
E, you come. I know my people respect you. If you say, they go, I just did something for my boy. He was like, E, I already know. They said your speech was the best. And my man said he bought so many books because of anything you need. So I'm trying to explain in the room, like, yo, it ain't even like, ain't nobody, the people I'm running with, we ain't even doing that. We doing influence for influence. Mm-hmm. That's doing impact for impact. That's creating income for income. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I'm like, y'all in this room, let's use each other's influence.
Yeah, and if I could, I don't even know if I'm supposed to, but I'm going to say it anyway because I think, you know, we see so many of the negative stories about some of these guys and stuff like that, man. And forgive me, I'm not going to name everybody. I'm just going to say two names of cats who I sat in there personally and was listening to them talk them and E going back and forth about, you know, social actions, you know, just a lot of stuff. And these brothers were super, super mature. Obviously, all stars on the court, but just like, I'm talking about like, you know how it is when you're in like a session, it's like the session go an hour, some change, something like that, like cats ready to get up out of there or mm-hmm. whatever. I'm talking about they asking questions, like great questions, and providing great feedback the whole nine. Jaylen Brown.
That was a different one.
The next day. Jaylen Brown and CJ McCollum, just super, super dudes. Like I said, I don't even know, whatever. I don't really care. I'm going to give them their props, get them a round of applause, because these dudes, like, you could tell that they really wanted the information and they really wanted to do something with it. I mean, they were talking about how to help the young players, how to help the community, and like having like real dope dialogue around that. And so, again, I know sometimes you think of the NBA players and they got the drip and the swag and they just selfish. These dudes really care and they doing something. And I'm excited to see what their career after the game really look like, because them is some really powerful bros, man.
Yeah, and again, if you're going to go that way, shout out to Kyrie. You know, Jaylen ran into Kyrie, and Kyrie was like, oh, yeah, no. I remember your dad when I was a freshman coming into Cleveland.
Yeah.
Cavaliers, you know what I'm saying, my first year. He came in and spit knowledge, you know, and he chopped it up with him. You know what I'm saying? I didn't even know he was in the room because I left afterwards, you know, because they was doing their thing. But he could have easily big-time Jaylen, act like he didn't know. Jaylen wasn't in the room, so he wouldn't have known, you know what I'm saying? But, he, of course, that meant a lot to my son, somebody that he look up to. Was like, yo, your dad came and spit knowledge. And, of course, Jay, like, I know, but I need to take it. You know, because sometimes when you're closer to it, you know, you don't necessarily. And so when you hear other people who you look up to go, I look up to your dad, that kind of, you know, whatever. So,
not sometimes, all the time.
Right. So shout out
to Kyrie.
My
sister just bought a building.
Right.
Just closed on a four-unit building, bro.
Man, come on, Carla. Congrats, Carla.
Congrats.
But yeah, I got
to the point. But now she got it. She finally now, when you're on the outside looking.
Carla was waiting until Mark got on TV. she like, I need to see if this is real or not. TV.
She made real estate real. Yeah. And now she's just happy as can be, man. Shout out to my sister. I'm proud of you.
Yeah, killing it. Absolutely. Shout out to Organifi as well, the Superfood Green Juice Powder, keeping us powered up throughout this pod. Also, man, we got what we got. We got 120 coming up,
dog. Chicago
around the corner.
Chicago.
Let me tell you something.
Hey, Chicago better come out.
I'm talking about.
Oh man, I know Maul about. Maul about to have his whole police team when he played football.
Hey, no, and Maul, I did an advertisement for I guess the 120 ads.
Yeah.
And Maul, I told him, I was like, yo, when I was coming up, you know, I did a different Chicago. I did Home Run Inn.
Yeah.
I did the candy store on 75th, 76th. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, we were stuck on 76 Lafayette. You know, remember you see the Muslim dudes at the beep?
Oh, yeah.
I'm like, yo, that was our reality. You know, the train, you know, we on the L going back and forth. Like, I said, but nah, bro, we on the 60th floor in the penthouse suite.
My.
Looking at the lake. You feel me? We looking at the pier from the
room. Slow that down. Slow that down.
We talking French now.
You got a little too much dip on your chip.
We in
the 16th floor.
Flip that W over.
We all got the same accent.
No.
They take advantage of it or not. They don't got nothing to do with
it. That remind me of Mexico, bro. I never forget. We said Mexico.
It's only one. It ain't like we got multiple.
Hey, I said I never forget this a day in my life, bro. We in Mexico, man, and me and Camille, we are looking at the lake.
Yeah.
And we say, man, it's so beautiful. Boy, this is really nice. We's like, man, and we just looking at the cloud, the sunshine. And we look up, and he is standing right above us. He is standing right above us, looking down. I'm like, no.
What would Jesus do?
We praying. We see E.
Look up for some E.T.
Yeah, you don't see E.
It must be the
sure.
one.
No.
For sure.
And Maul
and E. Like,
bless me to do
it. Don't we have a great view? I was looking at somebody's drawers hanging on a clothing line. He looking at talking about, don't we have a great view?
We all we got, y'all.
Bro, one of these days, bro, I promise you, I'm gonna be on the hip hop preacher level. So seriously, 120. Tell me what y'all excited about, man. I seen the lineup. He got a crazy lineup once again. Yeah. Tell them.
Jenna, Lisa, Tab. I got women who were all at one point on the outside trying to look in, and now they all on the inside. Mm. women. You know what I'm saying? But here's what I'm most excited about. I'm going to be honest. Yep. As I travel these schools and stuff, I'm like, y'all know what y'all really paying for? You're paying to get in a great community. Like, bro, the people that I'm bringing on stage, us, the people we attract that's coming, I'm like, yo, you one conference away from your Jonathan. You one conference away from your Jonathan, David. Like, you got one person that been a king, mm-hmm. been around king mm-hmm. stuff, and can help you become a king, and you ain't nowhere near.
Yeah.
Your family wasn't nowhere near kingdom. And you got a Jonathan who gonna build. You got a Ruth who gonna work on your behalf to blow you up. And I was like, you know what? Bump all of that. There are a lot of places you can go to get information. I don't know if you can get the kind of information Tab gonna give you, where she's gonna keep it 1,000. Jenna, you got Lisa, who billionaire. She started from the bottom, her and Tom. But you're not gonna be in a room with regular people who are not regular people.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm talking about? They're not gonna big time you. They're not gonna try to make it like you can't be where they are. So you are gonna get some phenomenal information. But I'm like, yo, you're about to be in an environment that's going to immediately increase your network, your net worth, all your everything. You're literally about to come into a space where you don't have to go no more. All my friends are, you about to come into a room like CJ said, all my friends are rich. I'm sorry, all my friends are wealthy. Because we doing marriage, we doing health. We got the five pillars. I hope people are signing up, doing the five pillars. But we're going to show you how to live the five pillars for little or nothing. Like, you mean to tell me you're going to be able to get into an environment for a couple hundred dollars with people on our level who can expose you to, you think about the Inky Johnsons, the Jeremys, the Tobys. You think about just the Alex of the world. You think about the Nickies and the Mooses. You think about deeper than the brand. Like, all that stuff came from what we built.
Hey, Jamal.
Makes real estate real. I'm sorry.
You know what I'm saying? Think about Jamal. Yeah. I'm saying, right. Before to make real estate real, right. Just from what was built, mm-hmm. and me coming, right. and being an audience, bro, coming to the events, bro.
He was, Jamal was making $32,000 a year when he met
cap,
us.
Big cap.
On the streets.
Big cap. Big cap. I was a millionaire when I met you, young fella. I was a millionaire, man, young fella.
With how many trainers? How many trainers did he have?
I had two.
He had two.
I had two.
You had two at the time? You had two back then?
Always had
not
two.
At the same time, okay. But all right, off but and on.
Two. Yeah,
Big Tommy was my partner. Yeah,
right.
And then I was working with Melvin already since I was in my
20s. That's funny, though, because some people who don't listen to the podcast religiously think, like, oh, Mar was a cop, then he met CJ. Yeah. And I don't be correcting him. I just be like,
no question.
I'd be like, that's how I was able to afford coming
all
to
this stuff.
All of this stuff.
But you look
like
at
that.
The investment you made and what you got in return.
Yeah.
So I want to say that's the bigger part. Getting in a community that you could have never gotten in on your own.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
That's the bigger
That's
piece.
Facts.
And for real, I talk about, you know, my meetings with billionaires and how that turned into another one. You feel me?
I tell people all the time, I'm not blowing, no smoke. I've gotten information that has been a sentence or two that has added a zero.
Yeah.
To my bank account. Yeah. I'm dead serious. Yeah. Like, literally a sentence or two that I heard. I promise you, I'm not the person who just gonna sit there and I got 5,000 pages of notes. I know what I need to hear.
Yeah.
And getting in a room like this, there are going to be people there that are gonna say something that's
not even on stage.
You. Oh my God.
Somebody
next to you. Yeah.
Just the environment alone. That's why I said I love about our events. We just attract good people.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's just good people
saying,
who wanna win.
Bro, I be saying, if you saw value in getting college credits.
Yeah.
You know, he's going through my daughter's. Yeah. And I'm like, you got to have, remember, you cut down some of her stuff.
Because
my daughter was like 16. I think she's trying to get like 16 hours or something.
Like,
and I'm like, the way they got the
slow
system.
Down, young fella. I've been bro, there.
She was like, she told us, she was saying, you only need 12. You don't need to be doing all of that.
Hey, listen, I know the system.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I was telling her. So my point was, again, what you in a rush to get through college for, right? What matters at Michigan State? Do they care how long it take you? They looking at your GPA.
Yep.
And at Michigan State, you can't get into your college without the GPA.
The GPA.
So you got kids coming in taking 16, 17 credits, getting a 2.5, not in a rush to hurry up, and they got to their junior year, and they can't even though they went way faster, they can't even get into the college of business, to the college of whatever, because they don't have a grade point average, but they got a whole bunch of credits.
But
somebody else could come behind them next year with the slow bop with 3.8 because they took their time and got everything right. And so that was kind of what I was explaining.
And that was the point I'm trying to make.
Yeah, right.
People out here looking for the credits.
Right. As opposed to coming but to these guests,
getting information. It's the information from somebody who's been there, done that.
You know what's so crazy with us that I think that's so fire with us? You're also getting the system. Mm-hmm. Like, yo, we literally going to give you, you know, the steps and how, because we actually did the work. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of people that can show you their Bentley, show you their house, show you their stuff, and then sell you a program, but they can't necessarily show you the steps. Mm-hmm. You feel me? Why? Because you ain't take none.
Mm, they showing you the stuff, not the steps.
Yeah, they showing you the stuff, not the steps, because you didn't take no steps.
Yeah.
So we were just talking about Adam being a counselor. Well, it makes it good that he talks about he was in prison.
Yeah.
Talks about that he had a drug addiction. Right. You feel me? So he actually got through the stuff that he about to tell you to get through. Not just he read in the book that you supposed to do these three steps.
I want to go more simple. I'm like, man, y'all watched the videos and got that much from the videos.
Yeah.
It was like a 5-minute video. Yeah. It was IG.
Yeah.
Like, you watch the videos that we put out from Make Real Estate. What I'm just saying, you watch the content. You listen to the podcast, and you just got something that changed your life.
And it's something, the energy of being in the room
with all
it's
that.
It's so funny, because somebody told a friend, a business partner, told somebody, like, hey, you need to, they called me, like, yo, can, you know, this guy who we about to do some business with, I want him to see he speak. And I guess the dude was like, yeah, I got a lot going on. I've seen him speak. Like, I know he's dynamic. I've seen him speak on the internet, you know, a million times. And I guess Tony was like, no. You need to go.
Yeah.
And then he was there in Vegas at the when he went off.
Oh,
that
so
boy
he got
came
it
up
full.
Was like, okay, I see why he wanted me here. I mean, it's the energy in the room, the ethos, different. The energy is different, man. Make sure you come out, if at all humanly possible, and get to Chicago.
And here's
man.
The biggest part why you need to be there. Because it's on the south side of Chicago, in the hood, and the visionary took a place that was nothing and turned it into baby Dubai. Like, y'all know how I talk about Dubai, bro. When you go to these rooms that he created.
Oh, yeah. I can't wait to see it. Like, the place where it's at, I haven't seen it, but they keep telling me about it.
It's Dubai.
Yeah.
Like, it's Dubai on the south side of Chicago.
Yep.
And it was $17 million.
Yep.
One man had a vision. I'm hoping that he's going to come
and
he's going to speak at the conference for us. Like, I'm like, yo, bro, take 30 minutes, 40 minutes, whatever you want. But, like, yo, you got to tell them how, where you came from, and you built a $17 million edifice. Like, they need, he's a visionary.
Yeah.
And I want them to be in the presence of a visionary. Because if you could see him and how he looked like you, like, you going to look at him and be like, yo, my man look like me.
He's real as they come.
And then you're going to be able to go, not to mention, I benefited from him. Y'all benefited from him. How? He raised Maul spiritually, Rondell spiritually. So we've benefited from his ministry before we even knew that
we
benefit from his ministry. And now he's going to allow us, and we like one of the first ones to be able to use the building.
Absolutely.
Like, they ain't letting people just use the building like that. And so it's brand new.
Crazy.
Man, Carl, it's a church, and it looked like, man,
arena.
Yo, he called me from that joint and was like, yo, I'm ready to go burn our whole church down.
Whole church down.
Yeah. And I thought we was doing something.
Oh, no doubt.
But you know what? I love for him to speak about just the faith thing, because it took him about 7 years.
7 years.
It took 7 years, bro.
The number of completion.
Completion. Bro, seriously. Took 7 years. He had this vision a long time ago, bro.
That's what I
said. Yeah, that's seven, bro. Hey, I want to make a commercial something, man, for Chicago to come out, dog. This is my home city.
Go ahead.
Okay. South side.
No, I'm talking about. Look at here. Like here.
Look right
at
him.
Act like it's Camille and talk to Chicago.
I'm talking about a real commercial. You know, with
make
everything.
Make one right now and we'll do one later
now. I want Carl to put the city of Chicago in the background.
Oh, we can do all of that right now. Go. I'll ad-lib right off the cuff. Go.
Oh, for sure. Chicago. Chi-town. What's up? Hey, meet me in the building, man. Look. 90% of that room need to be all from Chicago. Look, this is our home city. We need to represent. We need to come out. We need to support, bruh. Man, y'all already know. E is from Chicago. Man, I was raised in Chicago, born and raised. I live in Chicago still, man. Y'all come out, man. Let's represent, bruh. Let's show Chicago how we turn it out. Matter of fact, the last time we did a 120, right? Was that 120?
Yeah, that was Chicago.
1%? That was
1%.
That was 1%. Chicago came out.
Oh.
I'm talking about standing room only.
And that was only like about 1,500 seats.
That was only a 1,500 seat.
This
is 4,000. We need this place packed, y'all. Yeah. So, hey, man, anybody from Chicago, man, come on out, man. Let's do it. Let's show them how we do it, man.
That was fantastic. I'm excited, man. I'm ready. I think we're going to do a live pod, maybe.
Man, let me tell y'all something.
Are we going to do a live pod? Can we do a live pod?
I'm no? so geeked.
Maybe, yes?
Everybody going to be there, bro.
Everybody. E.M. Maul, born in Chicago.
Everybody, my
cousin. He raised in Detroit.
What's your list? What's your list of people that's just coming?
I want to make an announcement right now. Oh. There's no such thing as free tickets. Okay. I want to make that announcement now. No, let's make that announcement now. I'm paying. I bought a ticket already.
All right.
That's my new thing. I don't got no free tickets.
I like that.
So I'm saying I paid. Wow. So I'm just like, even you, my homie, my brother, my sister, like, I promise
buy
you.
Buy a ticket.
Yeah, I bought my ticket. Like, matter of fact, next time we come on the pod, I'm going to show y'all my purchase receipt. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to be like, bro, I can't do it. I'm going to tell you for two reasons I can't do it. I can't do it, one, because you need to just, it's about to be that fire where you're going to need to pay. Number two, I can't be responsible for y'all being at the dough trying to get in and the names. Right. It's too much.
Oh, okay? I'm leaving my phone at home.
I'm just telling you.
Bro, I can't even. My backyard. Yeah,
it's just everybody. I'm making my kids buy a ticket. We need a kids price, though.
No, yeah. Hey, let me tell you something. And, Maul, the energy going to be so fire.
It's going to be off the chain.
Because it'll be the first time I've ever spoken in Chicago and my grandmother wasn't there. It'll be the first time I've ever spoken.
Oh, Lord. Buckle up.
Oh, yeah.
Buckle up.
It's about Buckle to go down up. Her memory,
I'm going
to
mess with you. I'm going to get a banner with her on there. I'm going to mess with you.
It's about to go down.
Y'all make sure y'all in the building. Seriously, man. It's going to be, I feel like it's going to be one of those. And I feel like, you know, E, obviously, his grandmother being born in Chicago, still has family in Chicago. Maul being Mr.
Legacy.
Chicago.
Yeah. And speaking in my church.
Yeah. And it's the first time, though.
My church.
Maul spoke in Chicago before, and it was fire. He got a standing ovation. But this the first time Maul been like,
a speaker.
Full speaker activate.
So certified.
Listen, we're gonna budget about 3-4 hours for his keynote.
Oh, please don't give me 25 minutes. Hey, you know how hard that is? Remember, I used to trip out like, man, E, I used to call C like, C, E want me to speak for an hour. Like, bro, what am I? And then now I'm calling him up like, man, E just said I got 25 minutes.
Oh, he was hurt.
I was like, how am I going to do that? Hey. I was like, man.
Maul was like, I can't even get through. I tell you to close your eyes and create division for 25.
I said the introduction take 20 minutes.
Maul had 46 slides.
How long in the beginning?
How long did the eye close take?
At least 25. Maul be walking you through your whole life, have everybody crying. And then 25 minutes later, he'd be like, now open your eyes. And let's get this keynote started. You'd be like, bro, hold on. We've been here 30.
Bro, we going Eastern,
it's going down, bro.
We're in Eastern Michigan, dog.
He was going in.
It was like almost 2 hours, man.
Oh,
and
least.
I promise. And I still went through.
And he going to slide six.
And Maul was like, look, I'm going to cut this short for y'all.
And I'm like asking the team, what slide
six?
He got 40. No. I say he got 34 left.
Oh, yes. 34 left, bro. 34.
I'm going to do a 2-day conference and let just Maul have
Maul ready for that life. I think, no, we're going to do one where we let Maul for real get like 7-8 hours straight.
Yeah. Let's go.
Yeah,
meanwhile, you look at the GOAT. We in Mexico. E got up there.
He had
made about 20 slides. And he got off the first one.
I don't even know why he did that.
With his picture still sitting there.
With a graduate team getting a check.
He just wanted the team to do something.
It was so funny, right? He didn't even know that we was in Vegas, right? And he got, you know, it's the NBA stuff. And E slides like, I don't know who had your clicker.
I don't either.
Yeah, but anyway, he was like, he said something, and they was like, oh, are we supposed, like, the slide? Like, oh, we got to, I was like.
Don't even worry about it.
I was like, you're good. Don't even
worry about it. I went through one, and they couldn't do it.
I was like, look, that's background. Like, that ain't even for. Yeah. So anyway, man, what's the site they can go to? Is it 120series.com. Listen, go to 120series.com. Also, listen, all right. You got two chores. 120series.com. Go get your ticket. Also, if you have not pre-ordered the book,
you need to do that now.
Right now.
You need to do. Matter of fact,
seriously,
pre-order it, and then at 120 conference, I'm gonna give you a shout out if you see me and say, "Hey, I pre-ordered the book." I'm gonna be like, "Yo, shout out to you." I don't know if that's going to tickle anybody fancy, but I'm just trying to get y'all extra.
I'm just saying.
Just show me your, or if pre-order. You show me your order receipt.
Pre-order.
I'm going to do my best to
do something
have Maul take a picture with your family.
Yeah, do something. That's a lot of pictures.
Put them all out there.
That's a lot of pictures.
He could put them all out
I said
there.
I'm going to do my best.
Yeah, he said he was going to take pictures. Right.
Right. No.
Hey, it's Chicago, bro. Yeah, come up to me.
No, if you buy 100, come up to me. You get a pick with me.
If you pre-order.
One, you get a pick with Mark. 100.
If you pre-order, what you're telling bookstores and
yeah, for real. Be for real. All right, seriously.
We for real.
Yeah,
we rock the books.
Yeah, yep.
Because right now they're saying they only gonna print a few because they scared.
Right.
But the numbers we've been y'all been showing up, so thank
decent,
you.
Decent, decent.
Yeah, but y'all
decent.
Gotta come through. So they can, we want them to do over 100,000+ copies.
And right now they're saying they only gonna do what?
So they started at 25. Now they have 50. We getting there. So
again, we need to be over 100,000.
Yeah.
So they base that off of pre-orders.
Yeah.
Because listen, can I tell y'all the truth? All right, I'm going to be honest with y'all. I don't love the pre-order thing either.
Right.
I just be like, what if something happened? I don't get my money.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I get it.
Yeah.
I'm asking to override that thought. And I know you out there like, I'm going to just buy it when it come out.
Right, no question.
I'm asking you to override
but you
that
hurt
thought.
Me. So if you're trying to help me, you actually hurt me by waiting to buy it.
When it comes
and
out.
Because they're not going to print a whole bunch of books.
So
the more you pre-order, they say, oh, it's in demand.
Yeah.
So we got to print. Then the week that it comes out, I need you to buy. So we can get on the New York Best Time Sellers list, and then once I do that,
so then buy another one, and another one after that.
Well, if you give me two, I'm good.
Yeah, yeah.
And look, you've been watching videos for free. What's $50? You've been watching videos for
free
for years, right? I'm just asking you to invest $50 pre, and then the week it comes out,
and gift one,
and I'm saying just give it away. Yeah.
Somebody need it. Now listen, that's only for y'all who just level one. My ballers.
Yeah, I got a bulk.
I need
deal.
You to buy in bulk.
Yeah, I'll send you. I'll tell you how to do it. But
put the bulk link up right here. Whoever got the bulk link, put the
bulk link up. And know this.
And if you bought out, buy 100 and go take them to some schools.
So this is the deal. Yeah. You buy a bulk, you send that bulk to the school of your choice.
Mm. Mm.
So what happens is the school of your choice gets the bulk. We're gonna do a raffle with all the bulk orders, and I'm going to 5 schools for free. That got the bulk order.
That's fine. Right? That's fine.
And so one school
is good.
One school I'm going to do.
And what you should do too is whoever bought the bulk for that school, come with you.
Okay,
to the
no
school.
Problem. Yeah, you can go up to the school with me. But that's I'm going to raffle it off.
Yeah.
And I'm going to physically go to those schools and bless those kids.
How many they got to do to be considered bulk?
I think bulk, if I'm not mistaken, is like 100 books.
Okay.
I think. I don't know.
We'll have it on the site.
Yeah, it'll be on the site.
And for some of y'all, that ain't even still no money. What's that, $3,500, something like that?
I think bulk is $5,000.
Okay.
I think it's $5,000 for bulk.
Y'all got that kind of bread.
Yeah, but anyway, y'all, no question.
And
shout out to some people like Alex called me like, E, what's up?
Yeah.
Amber called me like, what's up with the bulk? So my people been calling me.
Yeah,
Mike,
for sure.
E, what's up? I'm ready to put it
on
school.
Yeah, of course,
And I just haven't, you know, I've been at schools doing stuff, but I'm going to stop since Carl said it's going to be on this recording, and I'm going to get all the information.
Yeah, so y'all go to 120series.com, go to ericthomas.com,
yes,
and
sir.
Pre-order the book. And let's get this thing cracking, man. I'm super excited about seeing y'all out and about, man, making this thing happen. So as always, man, we love you. We out of here. We'll see you next week.
I want you to focus on here right now. Don't you worry about when you get home. You make this, you concentrate on this opportunity. You don't worry about tomorrow. You concentrate on this opportunity.